Can software and AI make a decent webcam great? Well, this is the Lumina 4K AI camera, and instead of just going for the largest sensor, its trick actually lies in the power of the software and the AI-based image processing. So let's find out just how good it is. Okay, now I'll start with a basic hardware tour. So on the outside of the camera, it's a nice aluminum body. It looks really good from an industrial design standpoint. There are also four different color options. There's a five-element lens with an f2.0 lens stack. There's dual microphones as an array on the front. And you can see that it's got a USB-C connection in the back. There is a quarter 20 mount on the bottom and a magnetic lens cover that you can use and also swap its position to the back when you've got the camera in use. And there's also a status light on the right-hand side of the lens. The cable is USB-C on both ends, and it includes also a mount that I'm not showing right now with a quarter 20 thread. It's capable of 4K at 30 frames per second. Now this camera retails for $250 at the time of filming, and you can also get it for around $175 right now with current discounting they've put in place. Now this video, by the way, is in no way sponsored. I was able to actually find a lightly used secondhand version of the camera here for about $95. And if we round out the hardware tour, well, something that's unique about this camera is it actually comes with its own color card that's supposed to be used to calibrate the image. Now for me, that worked okay, but I suspect the metering on this camera is still using the entire frame left to right. So my blue RGB lighting and my black t-shirt didn't do it any favors. So why don't we see now how this camera looks and how it does with a bit of tuning, and also listen to its onboard microphone. All right, so this is the Lumina AI camera. I've got quite a few different settings tweaked, which I'll go through in a minute. Just so you can see what it looks like, kind of with the tuned image and hear what the microphone sounds like by default. There is no tuning available through the microphone. So this is what the microphone sounds like. It's about 2 feet or so from my mouth, but you'll be able to get an idea of the sound quality of the mic and kind of how the camera looks. I've got some background blur on. I've got a few different image tweaks. I didn't quite use what the card gave me in terms of the saturation, the contrast, the different gamma and other controls, but I'll walk through all those things that I did. This actually looks pretty comparable and pretty impressive to me, at least in terms of comparing that to some of my full-framed and APS-C Sony cameras. It's on the better end of the spectrum in terms of webcams. Okay, so now that you've seen it and heard it, let me show you some of the software that sets this webcam apart. Okay, so this is the Lumina Studio app. In the Detail tab, you'll find where you can turn on blurring and edge strength and blur padding. This is, again, the most configurable kind of background blur that I've ever seen. You don't want to go overboard on the person sharpness, by the way. Now all the settings in the RAW tab, these are going to be kind of the normal ones around white balance. Warmth is pretty unique, though, for a webcam. Hue isn't always available, and then you've got saturation. Now these thicker areas of the line are kind of where the camera more or less recommends that you stay in that range. You can actually set exposure on this camera, which in a lot of cameras will cause frames to drop. If you go back into settings, you'll see all the different specs. You can update the camera or the software from here. Here's where you can choose the resolution. So it starts at 720p. You can also choose the GPU that you want for the background and other blurring effects as well. And there you see the microphone volume. The microphone sounds really good in this camera, by the way. Contrast, you can set sharpness, gamma controls, which aren't in every camera for webcams. And you even see like curve lift, curve gain, curve offset, the raw sharpness for the raw feed from the UVC controls perspective. And you even have the white balance settings for red, green, and blue separated, kind of like on a full frame or a proper camera, where you can actually set the different hues for red, green, and blue, which most cameras don't let you do this. So it's actually pretty cool that they do that. And so green, for example, is where you'll turn things up if you've got a bit too much red, or if it looks a bit too purple, for example, like you see on some of the cameras from Logitech, for example. The green is actually a nice color to have. And then if you look at the framing, this is where you can actually use the AI auto framing. Now when you turn that on, basically the camera will zoom in a little bit, and you can see here We're zoomed in a bit, and the camera will actually track you. Now, I found the best setting here to be around 0.8 or 0.7. Otherwise, it starts to get a little bit too fast. So this is kind of the more tight position, and it actually moves, you know, in a pretty measured way. You can go a little bit wider frame, which is kind of more or less where my framing was on my Sony camera that I started the video with. And again, it's pretty good at these slower speeds. It can get a bit more distracting if you go to, say, a 2 or faster speed, but it's very configurable in terms of how fast you want it. Sometimes it jumps out like that, so I'm not a big fan of the auto tracking like in a static frame camera. I don't mind it on a camera with a gimbal, but it's actually not too bad if you keep it light and slow, like at 0.7 or 0.8. And by the way, those are just some of the main highlights from the software. There are even more options, and I can't show you everything, otherwise this would be like a 30-minute video. So what do I think of it? Well, honestly, overall, I really like the camera's computational photography and videography, and that's how today's flagship smartphones can really make small sensors and basic lens stacks look pretty amazing. The Lumina is basically taking a play from that playbook. The sensor is just 24.48 millimeters squared, which is a kind of a fancy misdirection set of terms to say that it's a 1 over 2.5 inch sensor, assuming that it's using a standard 4x3 aspect ratio. Now, if you Google search for its sensor size, then you'll probably see it's confused a few online reviewers to report it as a 24.48 millimeter sensor without mentioning the word square or squared or using the superscript of 2, which kind of makes it sound like a 1 inch sensor, but that wouldn't physically actually fit in this housing because the housing is only 22 millimeters tall or squared, so it wouldn't actually get a 1-inch sensor in there even diagonally. So I basically use the Sony sensor specs and a bit of math to derive the 1 over 2.5-inch sensor size. So why does that matter? Well, typically the sensor size is highly correlated to the dynamic range of the camera. Now, for all of the strengths of this web camera, the main weakness that I can see is that because of its dynamic range, it still looks like a webcam, not a DSLR or mirrorless full frame or APS-C camera, like some of the marketing actually implies. That said though, it's still one of the best webcams I've ever tested. The background blur is the best and most configurable option I've ever used in a webcam, even with kind of different software suites that you can use for background blur. The software has more control than any other webcam software I've ever tested. It's almost like going through the menu of my Sony mirrorless cameras, but with webcam software, which is pretty amazing. Now, the only things I'd love to see added are 60 frame per second support in 1080p and lower resolutions. And I'm guessing that the chipset probably supports that, but it's capped at 30 frames per second for things like HDR or to free up additional processing support like so many other webcams do. And if there ever is a version 2 of this camera, I'd love to see a bigger sensor and a bit more dynamic range, maybe a 1 over 2 inch sensor put into the camera's body. Now, is it worth the current $175 asking price? I would say yes, I think it is. I probably wouldn't say that at the full $250 MSRP price though. The software and AI alone is worth it. And as the owner of so many different webcams and proper cameras, I honestly wish this was a universal software package that could be used with other cameras and purchased separately. So let me know in the comments what you think, and as always, I hope this helps you out with your camera purchases, and thank you so much for joining me today and for watching.